Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the COVID-19 committee in 2021. This morning, the committee will be taking evidence from Michael Russell, Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution, Europe and External Affairs, Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director, and Emma Lipinska, Policy Manager, Coronavirus Legislation Coordination Reporting Team from the Scottish Government. This session gives members the opportunity to take any additional evidence on the expiry and extension regulations that we took evidence from yesterday from the First Minister and Chief Medical Officer, namely the Coronavirus Scotland Act's Amendment of Expiry Dates Regulations 2021 and the Coronavirus Scotland Act's Early Expiry and Suspension of Provisions Regulations 2021 SSI 2021/93. The committee will also consider the following regulations at today's meeting: Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Levels Scotland Amendment Number 16 Regulations 2021 SSI 2021/86. In addition, the Scottish Government has also provided the draft Number 17 regulations for this meeting, which have been circulated to members. Cabinet Secretary, can I welcome you to the meeting and can I invite you to make a brief opening statement?
Thank you very much, Convener. As you say, there's a great deal of material to get through. Let me divide my opening remarks into two. Firstly, on the regulations, the regulation for decision today deals with a very narrow category of driving instruction and testing, allowing it to take place where an organisation has delegated authority from the Driver and Vehicle Standards Agency carry out driver testing. They are allowed to do this even when an area is under level 4 restrictions. That impacts the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, the police and some bus companies. The inability to carry out driver training and testing has resulted in significant operational issues being experienced, and allowing such testing bolsters organisational resilience. The draft regulations that you have bring into law the issues raised by the First Minister in her statement on Tuesday. They remove a number of restrictions on socialising, sport and exercise in order to provide individuals with greater opportunities for social, recreational and sporting activity outdoors. They also permit activity for election purposes in level 4 areas from the 15th of March ahead of the Scottish Parliament election in May 2021, as anticipated in the statement from Graham Day last week. These regulations will be made later today, come into force tomorrow, that is on Friday the 12th of March. The change regarding election activity comes into force on the 15th of March. Then, Convener, if I can briefly address the draft Coronavirus Scotland Act's Amendment of Expiry Dates Regulation 2021, which I will call the Extension Regulations, and the Coronavirus Scotland Act's Early Expiry and Suspension Provisions Regulation 21, which I should refer to as the Expiry and Suspension Regulations. As the committee is aware, the Coronavirus Scotland Act was introduced in March and May last year, provide new powers and measures to protect the public, maintain essential public services and support the economy during the current outbreak. They are time limited. They will expire on the 31st March if the extension regulations are not approved by Parliament. In taking the decision to extend both acts, we gave careful consideration to the requirement to balance the needs of many stakeholders and partners who wish to see the powers remain available against the commitment that was given when the acts were introduced that the provisions would not remain in place unless that was necessary. We considered each provision on its own merits, and our reasoning for concluding that each provision proposed for extension is appropriate is set out in the very full statement of reasons, which is laid in Parliament and published on the 24th of February. Keeping in mind that commitment not to keep provisions in place unless they are necessary, the expiry and suspension regulations will expire 7 measures in the Acts on the 30th of March and will suspend provision relating to marriage and civil partnerships from that same date. I believe the approach we have taken, as the First Minister also indicated yesterday, is proportionate and appropriate to the scale of the ongoing risk posed by the coronavirus. Now, before I conclude, I should remind members that proposing that part one of both acts be extended at this time does not mean that all provisions covered by the extension will remain in place until the 30th of September. The Scottish Government will, of course, keep the continued necessity of these provisions under review. The required two monthly reporting will continue. And of course, the election that takes place, a new government would be in a position to take a position and to recommend that position to Parliament. And I hope those convener are useful introductions to the issues today.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I understand from broadcasting that my video is not working, so I'm trying to fix that. But I hope that everyone can still hear me, and I will now turn to questions. I would remind members that we only have approximately 5 minutes each for questions. If there's time for supplementaries, I'll indicate this once all members have had a chance to ask. And there is no obligation on members to ask questions. And if they want to let me know they don't intend to ask a question, can they do so in the chat function? I have just one question, and it's on the SSI 2021/86, which I think highlights the pressures that the emergency services are working under and the necessity of training further drivers to fill the gap of those who may be retiring in order to deliver emergency response services. And I just want to ask about what testing regime is in place to minimize the spread of the virus amongst key workers to ensure that emergency services aren't affected by staff shortages. I don't know whether you or Professor Leach could help with that, Cabinet Secretary.
I think that would be an issue for Professor Leach in terms of the detail of testing. I'm sure he will want to address it.
It's an important point, Convener. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for having me back. The symptomatic testing is, of course, available to the whole country, and that applies equally to first responders as it does to the rest of us. There are then individual guidance elements to what you should do in those jobs, but just testing, I'm afraid, doesn't protect us, as we've talked about many times here. If there are outbreaks, for example, in a police environment or in an ambulance service environment, then we can, of course, send rapid testing in there. But people would have to self-isolate irrespective of the testing, because that's about contact, not about positivity. So all of the testing regime is available around emergency services, just like it is everywhere else. But almost more important than the testing regime, so are all the other mitigations, the face coverings, the surface cleaning, all the other elements that we've put in place. And as we move through the vaccination programme, vaccination.
Thank you for that answer. Can I turn next to the Deputy Convener, Monica Lennon?
Thank you, Convener. Good that we can see you again. Professor Leach mentioned vaccination in his final word there. Can I just ask, and this might be happening already, but I've had some representation to say that it isn't, are student paramedics eligible to get the vaccine in Scotland? I've been told that it's been happening in Wales. I'd just get some clarification on that. And I suppose my only other question really is on testing, and in particular on asymptomatic testing in the community. I just wondered what the criteria is for the mobile testing units. Perhaps Professor Leach can explain. And also, we've had some locally in Lanarkshire that are going to be in place for 2 weeks. So by the time that they're often advertised, they're almost gone again. So what is the strategy for that over the coming weeks and months?
I think Professor Leach should answer those. I am aware that the experiment that has been done with using fire stations, for example, in the Highlands, has been very successful and very well received. But the detail of those questions is important, and I think Jason should address them.
So, relatively straightforward, Ms. Lennon. Students in healthcare who have frontline jobs within that, they are in the vaccination programme along with everybody else who has a frontline healthcare role. So, if you are in wards, if you are in ambulances, but if you are preclinical, you're not. So, it's all about the risk to those you serve. So student paramedics, at a point of being frontline clinicians, they are included with the rest of our frontline clinicians. If you have examples where that's not being done, please pass them on. Mobile testing units are at the beck and call of local public health professionals. So if a local incident management team or a local director of public health wishes to have mobile testing for whatever reason, then they can call on that, and we're very quick to put that in place. I take your point about the timing and the communication. I think that's important. I think that's something that MSPs can help with. It's something that third sector local media can, of course, help with as well. And we keep them in place for as long as they are required. The other layer is that local authorities can call on asymptomatic testing. If you just set up asymptomatic testing for the nation, the world suggests people won't necessarily come for that. So just setting up a tent and saying, anybody can come, there's no real problem here, but come if you think you need it. that doesn't work, as well as targeted. This is a region where we think there's high prevalence. Please come. We're checking around this workplace, or we're checking around this region of high prevalence. And local authorities can put in requests for that, and we'll respond to that at very, very short notice.
Thank you, Professor Leach. So is it based on prevalence, or are there any other criteria that apply?
If it were large, it'd be based on prevalence, but there are other kind of more micro areas where you might do it around a workplace, for example. So if a director of public health, just for example, if the director of public health in Dumfries suggested something had happened around a call centre or the local authority buildings or something, then they could call on mobile testing, asymptomatic testing for that specific piece of the puzzle. If they thought that had spread to Gretna, they could then put a mobile testing unit in Gretna, and we could put out a communication for the whole community.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Monica. Our next questions come from John Mason. John.
Much, convener. And it was really a couple of points coming out of Jean Freeman's letter yesterday, which came to MSPs. One point was around carers self-identifying and having to register themselves. Now, if I'm correct, that process hasn't started yet. So do carers need to do anything at the moment, or should they just be waiting?
Professor Leach may have a response to that. If he doesn't, we'll get you that information very quickly.
I have some of it. The only bit I don't have in my head, and I looked for it there in my head, is the actual date on which the portal becomes open. That may be in the letter, Mr. Mason, so you may actually have it in front of you.
We'll make sure it's provided.
So two ways of carers being identified. One is with carers allowance. So we know who those people are, we know their addresses, we know how to get to those individuals, and they will be caught up by their health boards and they will get invitations. The second way is self-identification. So we need people to use their common sense. We need people to come forward who are genuinely carers, and we will have a portal with which that can happen. GPs also know quite a lot about the caring responsibilities that their people have, their registrants have. So they will be able to put people onto that system. It's a big group. It's probably the most complex group, actually, as well as those with pre-existing conditions. So we're keen to get as many as we can, but we're also keen for it not to be an excuse for people just to randomly apply for a vaccination. That is not the purpose. The purpose is to protect those individuals and those they care for. So there will be a portal at which you self-register, and it's soon. I just can't remember the exact date.
That's great. Thanks very much. And my second point was, from what I understood, again, from Jean Freeman's letter, cohorts 6 to 9 are basically being vaccinated in parallel. Is that actually what's happening? So we're just basically going through 6 to 9 together?
Kind of. So we're giving flexibility to the health boards to do that as they require it. So that it does create some tension, particularly on social media, about my neighbour who's 60 getting to go before me who's 64. So don't look for exactly smooth age reduction, but we've now done 30% of the over 50s, for example. And that's principally because we've caught most of the ones who have pre-existing conditions. But in the islands community, for instance, in Orkney and Shetland, one of them has now done 50% of their local population. So there is some flexibility, depending on supply, depending on availability, for you to go into that group quicker than perhaps some other urban, larger areas will get to. And we just need people to be patient with us. But the end point is the same, mid-April for groups 1 to 9 for the whole nation. But in order to not have everybody finish on a Monday, have Tuesday off, and then start again on a Wednesday, we're trying to bring everybody in together so that we can keep that high number moving through.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks very much. Thanks, convener.
Thanks, John. Our next questions come from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Thanks. Good morning to you both. We had some quite strong evidence last week in committee from Inclusion Scotland about the impact of the crisis on people with disabilities. I think their point was that there's a lack of statistics, a lack of data, a lack of reporting. What's your response to that? I mean, you know, we're working our way through this crisis now, but how can we improve that? Is there sense in having some of that information on a dashboard? And perhaps if you could comment on your wider approach to health inequalities as well. You know, we have particular concerns about the BAME community, about deprived communities as well. How can we make sure that we're understanding what the health impacts are on particular groups who are facing a huge amount of growing inequality as a result of this crisis?
I think the issue of health inequalities I'd like Jason to address, but on the basic question of what we should take on board, you know, as a government and as a parliament and as a society, in terms of making sure that we publish information, that we collect information. It's not just publishing information, it's collect information. We are able to present that information in a way that's understandable. I think we are very open to continuing change and development of that. I don't think there's any resistance to that. Sorry, I think one of the issues is, however, it must be done in a way that is meaningful and adds to our ability to change and to develop policy. And I'm sure you would agree with this. It can't be done separately from that. And therefore, we need to be absolutely certain that what we're doing is not just collecting things for the sake of collecting things and not putting it in a context or in a way that would be very useful and helpful. So that's what we need to try and do. And within that regard, very open to it. I'm very happy to look at the evidence and to make sure that we come back to the committee and say, this is how we're going to handle this, this is how we're going to take it forward. But of course it is, and you're right to say, within the wider context of health inequalities, and Jason might want to address that.
So to the specific point about Inclusion Scotland, Mr. Erskine, I will look into that in detail. Gregor and I know it came up yesterday in Gregor's evidence, and he and I spoke briefly yesterday after his appearance, and this was one of the points he made. So we will look into their specific requests and the specific analysis that might be required or necessary, and we'll ask our analysts, is that happening? Can it happen? What is it difficult, etc., etc. And we'll be very happy to speak to Inclusion Scotland about their views on that. To your broader inequalities point, it does venture into the politics, which I will avoid. And with an election coming up, I will avoid it even more deeply. What I can tell you factually is that infectious disease exposes inequality. And we've said that before here. Every infectious disease, whether it's tuberculosis, flu or COVID, has a gradient of harm based on your social demographic. It is not universal. Some very well-off people have died and some very poor people will survive. It's not binary. But inequality is exposed by infectious disease, not caused by infectious disease. And therefore, you have to go upstream, which Sir Harry Burns taught me when I was a young man. So you have to move further upstream, and that's to do with poverty, it's to do with housing, it's to do with criminal justice, it's to do with education. It's the whole public sector. And I can assure you that inside the decision-making and the advice we give, that is considered. One of the harms, harm number three, is the social harm. The principal advisor for social harm is Carol Tannehill. I shouldn't maybe offer up witnesses, but you may wish to hear from Carol Tannehill at some point. She's a public health professional who has made her life's work exactly that, the inequalities of population health. And she leads our analysis, our information, our advice around social harm from both the virus, but also our response to the virus. And that is included in our four harms assessments, which then go to Mr. Russell and others to make the decisions.
Okay, thanks. I'll leave it there just now.
Thank you, Mark. Next questions are from Beatrice Wishart. Beatrice.
Thanks, convener, and good morning. I'd like to ask about the DVSA and driving lessons, and I appreciate the DVSA is a third issue, but in terms of the Northern Isles, which are in level three, and the inability to get a driving examiner to come from the mainland for to conduct driving tests because restrictions don't allow travel, I wonder what you might say to the young people in the Northern Isles who are desperate to get their driving tests and see that they're in a lower level than their mainland counterparts.
Well, I would say to them what I say to my own constituents who come to me in similar circumstances, sometimes in islands where they're also in level three. I would also make the point that, I don't know whose phone that is. Sorry, I think it's mine. My apologies. It was my phone. And Jason is obviously enjoying that. I would also say, and had to say, to a constituent who needed a driving license, who had come from another country, whose license was about to expire and who couldn't get a license test, I've tried to persuade the DVSA to show some flexibility in those circumstances. But it is a Westminster matter in order of showing that flexibility. I also, and I'm sure you have done this too, have asked the Transport Secretary what they can do. And I think that the Scottish Government has indicated they would like to see, in exceptional cases of hardship, to make sure that there was still the availability. But that has not happened as yet. And I think that would have been the answer to it, to find a way by which in exceptional cases of hardship that could be done. Now, the flexibility being shown with bodies that are allowed to operate, that are called delegated driving examiners, has been useful. There were over 300 tests deferred by bus companies because they could not operate. That has allowed a little bit of that difficulty and shortage to be dealt with. But I would very much like to get back to normality and driving tests as soon as possible.
Yeah, thank you. That's helpful. I mean, I think we all understand there's going to be a backlog when restrictions are eased. Could I turn to issues about vaccinations? I've been contacted by separate constituents aged over 65, and they're temporarily resident, one in England and one in Northern Ireland. I mean, they're there for quite legitimate reasons, but they've been unable to receive their vaccination in Shetland or register as a patient in their current location and receive it away from home. So I wondered if there are any formal reciprocal arrangements between Scotland and other nations of the UK for such a situation.
I think Jason should address that. I think we've all had constituency cases where individuals who have not been necessarily registered with a GP may have found themselves excluded in some way. And I think special arrangements by health boards have been made, I know, to make sure those people are included. But Jason might have some more information.
So this is more complex than it sounds initially, isn't it? It's people in all directions for whatever reason, whether they've had to move in to care for somebody or they've had to move for a job suddenly during the biggest vaccination programme in UK history. So there are some challenges in there. The best advice is to try and be registered with a general practitioner. That catches most people who move in and talk to the local healthcare system where you are, and the best way into that is a GP, whether that's somebody moving to Shetland or moving out of Shetland or any other area. Failing that, if you are very temporary, then we will catch you when you come back. If you're in the middle group where you haven't actually moved and you're not just there for 2 or 3 weeks, then you'll have to contact the local health delivery system. Now, we have systems in place to do that in Glasgow and Edinburgh for people who are coming to us. I'm not in charge or know the systems in England, but I'm absolutely certain that those English and Irish and Welsh systems would find ways around that. If there are individual cases that don't manage and it gets too complex, then you should write into us and we will try and unravel that for you.
Thank you for that. You can expect a letter shortly because they've tried the options that you've suggested. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Beatrice. Our next questions come from Annabel Ewing. Annabel.
Good morning, Convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and to Professor Leach. Just a few questions today. Some of the issues I had thought of raising have already been asked and answered. Firstly, the emergency legislation, a question I asked last week of Michael Clancy of the Lost Society of Scotland, and I should remind everybody that I am a member of Lost Society of Scotland. I asked Michael Clancy if he thought that there was any alternative to the extension, taking into account in particular the fact that we are still in lockdown, the pandemic is still very much with us, Parliament is about to go into recess, we are then about to go into election, new Parliament from elected on the 6th of May. And taking all that into account, I put that question to him, and he responded that, in his view anyway, he didn't see any alternative to an extension of the emergency legislation. So could the Cabinet Secretary perhaps comment on that matter? Thank you.
Well, I think Michael Clancy is right in that regard. I mean, the situation that we are in is that the legislation expires on the 31st of March. It's, of course, we've renewed it once, and it can be renewed once more. Renewing it does not mean it has to be in place for the full 6 months. You know, any and all of the items could be suspended or got rid of at any stage. But if we were not to do this, then the framework that we have to allow us to operate in the current circumstances would disappear. And we would have to construct something else in its place at a time when, well, we have 5 sitting days left of the Parliament. We then have an election, and we have the formation of a government. I mean, I just think it's inconceivable that we would not do this. Now, we have tried very hard to examine the contents of both of the Scottish Acts. You know, we don't have total control of the UK Act, clearly, but we've examined very carefully where we are. We have tried to make sure that the things that we don't think are needed are got rid of. And we've been very clear about that. I mean, the document we published was very clear indeed in terms of the statement of reasons. I just do not believe there is an alternative, but nobody wants this to be in place for any longer than it has to be. And a new government coming in will be able to take instant action, as it will a new parliament if it chooses to do so. So I think it would be foolish at this stage, very foolish at this stage, to get rid of it, to say, oh, we don't need it. I think that would be playing to a small, perhaps vocal, but not representative and quite dangerous gallery. I don't know if Jason Leach has a view about regulation and how it should continue. Given the nature of the pandemic, I think the advice that the Cabinet receives is that there is still a distance to go in this matter.
Well, perhaps just context rather than a view on how the Parliament and how parliamentarians should react to that context, which isn't for me. The context is that in a lot of the world, the pandemic is accelerating. In half of Europe, it is still going up. I looked this morning at some numbers for European countries in light of news about the new variant. So Sweden has now got over 60-70% of its virus is the Kent variant, and its numbers are rising. The Czech Republic is rising, Hungary is rising, etc. A million people in Europe caught this virus in the last 7 days, and after 6 weeks or 7 weeks, forgive me for not knowing exactly, of deceleration across Europe, it has now upticked. Now, we, fortunately, are still on the downward slope, and we are confident that gradual opening and all of these things will cause us to stay on that downward slope, but we cannot guarantee it. The new variant, no country has opened with the new variant at 90% of its virus. No country in the world, because we are first. So that causes us to be very, very cautious. So therefore, our advice is that we should keep in place restrictions. Now, the nature of those restrictions is the debate we're now having over the next few weeks and months, and that gradual easing over 3-week periods, what you do for schools, how you prioritise individual freedoms with places of worship, with all of those other things. That's a different question. But the advice is very clear that the country still needs safety measures.
I thank both the Cabinet Secretary and Professor Leach for those fairly unequivocal responses. My second issue concerns the welcome development, I think, to take effect from today, the meeting outside, including for social purposes, of 4 people from 2 households. I think, certainly, constituents who've contacted me, there still seems a slight lack of clarity in their minds as to how that sits alongside the travel restrictions. And I think it would just be helpful if there could be a clear statement in that regard, in case anybody is under any misapprehension about the fact that the travel restrictions are still very much there. But it would be helpful if somebody could do that. Thanks.
Well, let me just make it very clear that everybody would welcome, and I'm sure does welcome, the fact that from tomorrow, and I just want to make it clear, it's from tomorrow, not from today. No. The regulation will come from today, but it's from tomorrow, from the 12th. we will be four people will be able to meet from two households. And that's very welcome. That hasn't existed since Christmas time, and it's very welcome indeed. However, the requirement to stay at home exists and continues to exist. That has not been taken out of the consideration. So people should stay at home. They should work from home. In terms of travel, it is possible for the purposes of travel to travel shortish distances, 5 miles essentially, outside your own local authority area too, but for very narrow reasons. And there's strong advice, indeed, the regulation is stay at home. And as time goes on, and the First Minister will address this on Tuesday, I know, there will be an indication of indicative dates of how we can move on from there. But this is a small but significant step, and there are other things in there too, as Annabel Ewing knows. There's an issue of non-contact sports, and gatherings of young people. Those are very important things, and an indication of when the restrictions on church services will be and the opening of church buildings will be lifted, provided things are still moving in the right direction. So it's all in there, but this is a small step. People should treat it as a small step. But they will welcome the small step, because from tomorrow, four people from two households can meet together out of doors, properly distanced and being careful. That's a good step forward.
Thank you for that. Sorry, Cabinet Secretary, I was a day ahead of myself in that kind of week.
We're all trying to be a day ahead of ourselves, but thank you for saying it.
My last question, picking up on the issue of non-contact sports, and I have written to the sports minister a while back actually about this, but it's the issue of, and in this case it happens to be young gymnasts who in Scotland have not been able to train, and that's different to the position I understand south of the border. And in terms of the looming Olympics, assuming that still goes ahead, certainly there's a concern that they feel they're going to be very much further behind the curve. And I just wonder, and perhaps this is a question for Professor Leach, what consideration can be given to these particular sets of circumstances where you are actually dealing with elite athletes?
It's a good question, Ms Ewing. Elite athletes are exempt, but within very strict restrictions. And Sport Scotland's website is the place to go to for that. I'm afraid some youth training and further down the pipeline is restricted. I have a great friend, a family friend, whose 10-year-old is up there with Scottish gymnastics and hoping to be one of those future Olympians. He is spending his time doing training outdoors and in his own home, in fact, raising a great deal of money for Epilepsy Scotland this week, in fact, doing 5,000 turns on a pommel horse. So he should get a special mention, perhaps. But the point is still well made that the pandemic will require us to catch up with some of that. But the high end is still allowed. The high end have privileges. They also have responsibilities inside those privileges. And Sport Scotland have done everything they can. We have an elite sport advisory group chaired by one of my colleagues who works with me, and we've tried to keep as much of that open as we possibly can, particularly to allow those Olympians, Paralympians and others to be able to go to the next versions of those. The time after that and the time after that is what we have to catch up with.
I thank Professor Leach for the answer. Obviously, my constituents will remain disappointed with the ongoing restrictions, and I just hope that the matter can be kept under constant advisement, because for these young people, this is their first moment, and they feel that they're going to completely miss out, whereas their competitor colleagues down south will not. And I just think that's it's a real shame, but hopefully it can continue to be looked at. But I think that's my time, convener, so thank you very much.
Thank you, Annabel. Our next questions come from Maurice Corrie. Maurice.
Ravina, good morning. Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning, Professor Leach. I have two questions on driving tests and vaccinations for seafarers. Cabinet Secretary, the first question is on driving tests. What about key workers who need to get a driving test for helping with their work, such as nurses, carers, occupational therapists who are required, and particularly areas in the remoteness of this country are needed? Can they not have the same privilege to get their driving test through as emergency services?
Well, I would like to see that. I would very much like to see that happen, Mr. Corrie, but it is not in my gift. It is in the gift of the DVSA. I have made representations on behalf of the constituents. I'm sure we have all done the same, but it is up to the DVSA to decide when they're going to reintroduce driving tests, and the DVSA is a reserved body. So that representation has to be made by MPs at Westminster. I know the Cabinet Secretary for Transport is cited and has indicated he would like to see this change too, but I can't answer that question. That has to be the DVSA. But if it were to happen, I would be very pleased, and I think it would be useful.
Yeah, so the Cabinet Secretary for Transport in Scottish Government is actually taking that case forward.
He has said that he made it clear to me he wants to happen, but he can't do anything about it. You know, that has to come from Westminster. So I'm sure we could all prevail upon colleagues, and you can prevail perhaps more closely on colleagues, given the nature of the government at Westminster, to get a move on with that. And I'm sure we'd all be grateful to you, Mr. Murray.
Yes, we take that advice, Cabinet Secretary. Professor Leach, on the question of vaccinated seafarers, in Singapore, the Singapore government has actually sorted this out so that seafarers who have returned to sea go to sea now vaccinated. Can the same procedure be done for our seamen in Scotland and seafarers who are obviously rotating in and out of the country back to their ships or back to wherever they go and home again, but particularly those who are going off to sea this year? Can this be sorted out as a priority before they go off to sea? If it can be done by the Singapore government, surely the Scottish government can do it.
The answer to your final question is yes, we could, but we take our advice from the Joint Committee on Vaccination, which the Singaporean government don't. They take their advice from their expert group on vaccination, our expert group on vaccination, from which we have never departed in 30 years, let me remind you, has decided not to do that at this point in the pandemic and at this point of vaccination supply. So that will change once we get a regular supply of 4.5 million doses a month or whatever it becomes. Then there will be other alternative decisions to make inside that prioritisation. For now, the vaccine priority is to reduce death and hospitalisation from COVID. So therefore, we have to prioritise those most at that risk. And that is not seafarers. That is older people and looking as you come down. And the only occupational exemption to that is health and social care workers. That's what the Joint Committee have said. That's what the Scottish Government has decided to do. But I don't think that's forever, Mr. Corrie. I think as supply increases and as we get into probably a regular rhythm of vaccination, then exactly what you suggest will have to logistically be done.
Professor Leach, how, therefore, from your point of view and your expertise, how far up the list would you put seafarers to get them once you get into this so-called rhythm?
That'll be a matter for both the Joint Committee and for governments, us, to make some choices about at the time. If you think about the flu vaccination programme, remember, the flu vaccination programme is not directly comparable because we don't vaccinate the whole population. This is much, much bigger. But the flu vaccination programme does take account of risk in a slightly different way than this one, where vaccines coming in 30,000 chunks at a time and you have to work your way through the ages. So professional prioritisation will then happen, particularly logistically. We'll still want to go through the whole population as quick as we can, which is the most important thing. But if people are on oil rigs for 6 weeks and they miss their appointment, then it would make sense to do them before they leave for the oil rig. Just now, we don't have the supply to be able to do that. So I would have thought the logistics of that would make sense rather than the prioritising seafarers thing, which doesn't make sense. But the just simply getting them done does make sense.
Right. So,
Sorry. Can you stop? I think, Morris, before we return to you, I think the Cabinet Secretary wants to come in, and then if we could return to Morris.
Sorry. I beg your pardon.
I'd be very grateful. Thank you very much, Convener. I just want to make the point about seafarers. I've had substantial representations. So I fully understand the difficulty. And I understand the difficulty, too, of people who may be working offshore or elsewhere, come back and they have to spend a substantial amount of their time, and sometimes their own money, in the process of being quarantined in hotels. Nothing would give us greater pleasure than to stop that happening. But, you know, Jason has been very, very clear. If we will not and should not depart from the Joint Committee recommendations, that is what we are trying to follow. And then also, you know, and Jason has given evidence on this, I think, on almost every occasion that we've been at the committee, but also absolutely determined to try and ensure that variants that might come in here and undo all the work that's being done are kept out as far as humanly possible. And that doesn't mean, and I just want to stress this, and I'm sure you're not saying this, Mr. Corrie, but I just want to stress this. That doesn't mean that I am diminishing or anybody is diminishing the contribution of seafarers or ignoring the difficulty of the problems they have. But it is a realistic assessment of what we regard as necessary at this stage, regrettably. And we all have to regrettably say that to our constituents. And I just want to make that very, very clear. And the sooner we can move on from that, when we have taken the communal and joint actions to suppress the virus, the happier we will all be.
Okay, thank you, Councillor. Can I return to Professor Leach to my final question, if I may, Convener? Coming back to your concept of rhythm, Professor Leach, giving to that, are you able to do that in relation to your rhythm idea and the 4.5 million doses per month?
Sorry, I missed the first part of your question, Mr. Corrie. It's okay.
The rhythm, okay, within this business of vaccinations. I mean, obviously concentrating on seafarers here. Can you give us some timescales when you believe this rhythm will get to that stage?
I think probably the autumn at the earliest. What we are anticipating, although quite a lot of this is unknown, what we're anticipating is probably annual vaccination. That's what most of the experts in respiratory viruses and vaccination expect we will need. And that would mean a booster dose for those who have already been done, which will be the whole population, the whole adult population, by the end of July. And that would happen probably going into winter 2021. I can't know that for sure. It may be that immunity lasts long enough that we can do it in the spring. But let's just presume that we've got manufacturing upscaled, the world is ready, and we can then do 4.5 million people in the winter of 2021. That would make sense. That would be alongside the flu vaccination programme for some people, and it would be independent of the flu vaccination programme for others. At that point, you can then think about prioritising in a slightly different way. And it's not so much about prioritising, because you would still be doing everybody, but your logistics would look slightly different. So you might do young people in colleges, for example, because they would be in the college. So the logistics of how you do the vaccination programme would look different. We probably wouldn't do everybody at the Louisa Jordan. We would probably do people at their GP practices when they were getting the flu vaccine, for example, if they were in that group. So it's not so much that your priorities would change, you would just change the way you delivered the service.
Good. Thank you, President, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I appreciate your answers, and that's good to get some sort of meat on the bones there. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Maurice. Our next questions come from Stuart McMillan. Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. It's just two questions. It's probably more aimed towards Professor Leach. So the first question is to do with the asthma and vaccine. On the NHS and Forum website, it states that asthma, quote, is asthma that requires continuous or repeated use of systemic steroids or with previous exacerbations requiring hospital admission. That patients who are well controlled on asthma inhalers are not eligible in priority group 6 for coronavirus vaccination. So I'm just seeking a bit of clarification. Does this then mean that if you have ever been hospitalised due to asthma, that you will be vaccinated? But also, how recently should someone have had been on the systemic steroids to qualify?
Well, thank you, Mr. McMillan. It's good to clarify. The first point is everybody will be vaccinated, every adult, by the end of July. This is only about bringing people forward into group 6. So every asthmatic in the country will be vaccinated. Your second point, though, is who goes in group 6. It's quite a difficult judgment for the Joint Committee, because asthma is a is a long line of disease, a bit like many other diseases. It's not binary. The risk with asthma increases as your asthma gets more severe. So their cutoff is exactly as you've just read out on NHS Inform. There is no statute of limitations on the hospitalisation, so there is no time limit on the hospitalisation point, but it will be a clinical judgment for those who are putting people on to group six. And there is a time limit on the steroids. So the steroids is a more recent way of judging severity than others.
Just on the steroids then, can you tell me what that time limit is, please?
It's exactly what you read out on NHS Inform. So it's the number of doses within 2 to 3 years or something like that.
Right. Okay. No, thank you. Second question is just to do with care homes. And once again, it's probably more directed towards Professor Leach. I was contacted by a constituent last week whose husband is in a local care home. They've got three adult children. And so as a family, they're discussing kind of what they need to do to determine which of the adults can then be a second visitor. So there's various things have been discussed. So would they be allowed to change the visitors every 2 weeks to be in a position that the father would be able to see his children at some point over a period of time?
This is so difficult, Mr. McMillan. It's so difficult. We would ask them not to do that at this stage of the pandemic. The reason for that is we're trying to cut down the number of human interactions and the number of different people. I know that sounds so harsh and so horrible. I am very hopeful that as we come out, we will be able to make those care home restrictions even more relaxed. They're hardly relaxed, but there will be the opportunity to add more people in there. Just now, we'd like people to stick with the two designated visitors, bearing in mind that other visits are allowed in times of crisis, so end of life, distress, other times when people may wish to do that. But the family two designated visitors, it's so difficult, but we'd ask people to make a choice.
Okay, no, thank you. Thank you for that. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Stuart. And finally, Willie Coffey. Willie.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, everybody. Cabinet Secretary, Professor Leach, were kind of hurtling towards Easter, although it doesn't feel like that at the moment down here in Ayrshire. It's still pretty cold. But on behalf of our garden centres, nurseries and so on, could you perhaps offer them a wee glimmer of hope that over the next few weeks there might be some kind of relaxation that might apply to that sector? As you know, they operate pretty much in the outdoors, a substantial parts of their business. So is there any crumb of comfort that you could perhaps offer to the garden centre and nursery sector, please?
Well, I think there's a crumb of comfort for all of us. And it's the garden sectors whom I'm very supportive of. I mean, you know, I'm supportive of all the sectors. The crumb of comfort is that if we continue to go the way we're going, we work very hard to keep the progress that we've got. If I may use this phrase, screw the nut on this and make sure that we do what we need to do, then you know we are all going to be in a better position week by week and month by month. And just as I'm making clear about the regulations, this won't last longer than it needs to last. But if we don't do that, then it's not just the garden centres that will find it difficult. Everybody will find it difficult. So that's why we all just have to make sure we keep moving forward with this. On Tuesday, as the First Minister has indicated, she'll try and give some more indicative dates. We will keep a very close eye on the data that is coming to us, and the Cabinet considers this very, very carefully every single week and between meetings, of course, as well. And we will get there, and we should give everybody that hope. We will get there. We are getting there. The huge sacrifices we've seen are paying off, but we have to keep together on this. I don't know what Jason wants to add to that, but it is really important that that message gets out there.
I was going to make the same hope jump from that individual question to hope for the country. I think each sector, of course, wants to be open. Each sector also thinks transmission doesn't happen inside their environment. Let's be clear, that fact still arises in the email correspondence I get. However, garden centres do have outdoor space. They are able to do some things safer in their environments than in other parts of their environment. And I think the level system will talk about what that kind of retail is and when it will be allowed and at what stage of the pandemic in each of the regions of the country it will be allowed. So I think they can have hope as long as the numbers continue to fall.
Okay. Thanks to both of you. Thank you very much, Camilla.
Thank you, Willie. And that concludes our consideration of this agenda item. And can I thank, as ever, the Cabinet Secretary, Professor Leach, and Ms. Lipinska for their evidence and attendance this morning. We now move on to agenda item two, subordinate legislation. And we consider the motions that we have taken evidence on in the previous agenda item. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to make any further remarks on the SSIs before we take the motions?
No, I'm quite content. Thank you.
I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion S5M 24235 that the COVID-19 Committee recommends that the Coronavirus Scotland Act's Amendment of Expiry Dates Regulations 2021 be approved.
Moved.
Does any member wish to speak on the motion? And if so, could you indicate this by typing R in the chat box? And at this stage, I would like to advise that I have some comments to make, and I make these comments from a party perspective, not as convener. I am troubled by the extension of the emergency legislation for a further 6 months to September 21. And I say that in full recognition that the Scottish Government and the Cabinet Secretary himself have taken a constructive approach to these matters and, for example, have expired some redundant provisions. But last week, we had some powerful evidence at this committee from Inclusion Scotland, representing disabled groups, and the Scottish Police Federation, who, from very different perspectives, were of the view that instead of simply extending the legislation, we should at this point take stock. And I agree with that. A full year has passed and so much has happened within that time. And I think it is correct to analyse what has worked and what has not worked, especially in light of the impact of emergency legislation on civil liberties and human rights. It's also worth noting that the Scottish Coronavirus Acts, which are the subject of this potential extension, do not contain health protection measures or the power to make health protection measures. None of us want emergency legislation to persist. I also think it's significant we are about to enter into an election period. When a new parliament is elected and then a new administration is formed, it is likely we will continue to have suppressed the virus. We will be much further along in terms of vaccination, and hopefully the virus will be in full retreat. And accordingly, we should be in a much less restrictive position in terms of our everyday lives. So in my view, it would be right for a new administration with an electoral mandate at that point to decide whether emergency legislation is required, and if so, in what form. So for those reasons, I will be voting against this SSI. Does any other member want to comment before I turn to the Cabinet Secretary? Cabinet Secretary, would you like to make any remarks?
Well, only to say that I'm very disappointed to hear that the Scottish Conservatives have taken that position. It seems to me that there is nothing in what I have said and what the regulations say that is inconsistent with the view that an incoming government can take stock and to look at this situation again. And indeed, I emphasised that at the very beginning of what I said. But what the proposal from the Scottish Conservatives is will be to leave Scotland without defence that comes from these regulations. I think that is a foolish thing to do. And I think that in so doing, it is letting the people of Scotland down. And I would therefore hope that other members of the committee would stand up for the people of Scotland, make sure that the regulations continue and the legislation continues in place. And in so doing, that means that after the election, a new government and a new parliament can make decisions. I regret that this type of politics has entered this. It is very much, in my view, the wrong thing to happen. And I hope the committee will continue to support the legislation.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I will now put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S5M 24235 be agreed to. Does any member disagree? And if so, please type N in the chat bar now. There is therefore going to be a division. And can I firstly invite the clerk to type in the motion number into the chat bar? Can I firstly invite all members who agree to the motion to type Y into the chat bar first? Thank you. Can I now invite all those members who disagree with the motion to type N into the chat bar now? I think there are no other members to vote, but any other member wishing to abstain can, of course, type A. I will now ask the clerks to send me the result, which I will read out in full. On motion S5M24235, those members voting for were Monica Lennon, Willie Coffey, Annabel Ewing, John Mason, Stuart McMillan, Mark Ruskell, Beatrice Wishart. Those members voting against were Donald Cameron and Maurice Corry, and there were no abstentions, and therefore the motion is agreed to. I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to move the second item of legislation, that is motion S5M24188, that the COVID-19 Committee recommends that the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Level Scotland Amendment Number 16 Regulations 2021 SSI 2021/86 be approved.
Moved.
Does any member wish to speak on the motion? And if so, could you please indicate this by typing R in the chat bar? I note that no member wishes to speak, and therefore I will now put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S5M24188 be agreed to. Does any member disagree? And if so, please type N in the chat bar now. No members have responded. There is therefore no division, and I can confirm that this motion is agreed to. The committee will publish a report to the Parliament setting out our decision on the statutory instruments considered at this meeting in due course. And that concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Cabinet Secretary and his supporting officials. Can I thank you for your time this morning, and you please feel free to leave the meeting. We now move on to agenda item three. Agenda item three is consideration of the evidence heard earlier in the meeting on the Coronavirus Scotland Act Early Expiry and Suspension of Provisions Regulations 2021 SSI 2021/93. This is a negative instrument, which means the Parliament has 40 days to consider a motion to annul the instrument. We have taken evidence on the instrument from the Cabinet Secretary this morning, and a motion to annul this instrument has not been lodged. Does any member wish to make any further comments on this negative instrument before our consideration is concluded? And if so, could you please indicate this by typing R in the chat bar now? I know no member has indicated they want to comment, and therefore are members therefore content that this concludes our scrutiny of this negative instrument? Thank you. It appears that members are content that this concludes scrutiny of this negative instrument, and we shall now move on to the next agenda item, which is item number four, the annual report. The next agenda item is the committee's annual report. Members are invited to consider the draft annual report for the parliamentary year from the 12th of May 2020 to the 4th of May 2021. Does any member wish to make any comments on the annual report? And if so, could you please indicate this by typing R in the chat bar? Thank you. I note that Willie Coffey would like to comment on the annual report. Willie, please feel free to comment.
Donald, thanks. It's a good report. what I was thinking is the number of times that the Cabinet Secretary and Jason Leach have appeared to support this committee has been quite substantial. I was hoping that members would perhaps agree to recognise that in the text. I'm having a look through it, Donald, but I can't quite see anything that might reflect that sentiment. So I was hopeful that the members would agree to recognise the substantial nature of support given by both of them to the committee.
Willie, I think that that's an excellent point, and the clerks will be noting that comment and any others. And I think it is entirely feasible for us to acknowledge that. There will be some very further minor changes to update the witness numbers and clarify any typographical errors. And I think we can easily include a line along the lines that you just suggested, because I think it is a good point. I note Annabelle agrees with that. And John, you have a comment on paragraph 59. Please comment.
No, it was to say that I think answers Willie Coffey's point. Paragraph 59 refers to the number of times that Mike Russell and Jason Leach have come. But I mean, we could maybe add something about how much we appreciated that.
Yes, I think it's important to acknowledge the attendance beyond simply stating how many times they've attended. So I think it would be right to put in a brief line about our appreciation of their consistent attendance at this committee. If anyone disagrees with that, please let me know now. But I think it's a good point, well made. Monica.
Thank you, convener. Just to agree with the comments that have been made, and also just to recognise not only did the Cabinet Secretary and his officials, in particular Jason Leach, attend almost every week, but they've also been very good at following up questions with written answers when they're not able to give the information on the day, and we've all had to work at pace. But I think it's a good report, and it's good to see the range of witnesses mentioned, and of course the important contribution of the Citizens Panel. And really just a thank you to all the committee members who've served at various times, but in particular to the clerks who are unseen behind the scenes, and everyone who's been involved with broadcasting. We've met a huge number of times, we've had long sessions, there's been some technical issues along the way, but I think we've been able to be really inclusive and capture the views of the public as well, which is really important. So I'm just grateful to everyone who's been on the committee, and I think the report is a good reflection of the work that's been done.
Thank you. And I would echo those sentiments myself, Monica. Thank you. Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, I would agree with those comments of Monica as well. I think the committee has made some really substantial progress in the last 6 months. I think in particular bringing in independent advisors has been a real progress, I think, in terms of deepening our understanding as a committee, our ability to scrutinise government. I think the continued work that the Parliament's doing on deliberative democracy, on bringing in citizens' assemblies and panels, has been, you know, really, really worthwhile, and I think is something that the whole Parliament needs to continue to reflect on. And I think, yeah, the commitment from the government to come every week and to be placed under scrutiny, I think is important. I think that's what government should do. But appreciative of the time commitment, particularly from Mike Russell and Professor Leach on that. So I think this is a good report. And I think the other thing also, which I think is captured in the report, is that, you know, we've started to take very much a forward look at these things. So I think previously, perhaps the committee was quite reactive, looking at, made affirmative regulations that were coming forward, whereas now we've actually started to get into looking at the long-term strategy for how we deal with pandemics and COVID. So I think, you know, the committee's had to learn a lot in the last year, but I think it's done some fantastic work. And if it means that we have to meet once or twice during the recess period to continue the scrutiny, then that's just something that we need to do as well.
Thank you, Mark. Maurice, and then Annabelle.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Convener. Yes, I would concur with all those points that Monica has made and also Mark and yourself. I think it's important that we do really recognise what goes on behind the scenes led by Sigrun and her team. I think that's important as well, because of that, then we couldn't do it. And I think what Mark was saying was very interesting. It's a forward-looking, yes, the Citizens Assemblies, we've had some interesting discussions on that. And I think that is part of the forward approach that we need to take with this Parliament, which is obviously all-inclusive. So I just say I think it's been a good year, and I've enjoyed it very much the time I've been here. And I wish it well going forward in the new Parliament. And thank you to everybody who's partaken in it and the team that support us so well in the clerking team. But thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Maurice. Annabel?
Yeah, I would just like to say briefly that I entirely agree with the comments from colleagues. And I think another important issue to stress is that the COVID committee has given members of the public, importantly, the opportunity to follow some of these quite complicated issues in more detail week by week. And I think that is really important when we're all struggling to deal with all the various strands that have come to the fore as a result of the pandemic. And also, I would wish to thank everybody that makes that possible, including all of those behind the scenes, the clerks and broadcasting, because otherwise we would just be talking to ourselves, which would not necessarily be a good thing. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Annabel. Stuart, I know you comment about Mark's point about looking forward, so I acknowledge that. Our clerks will be noting these remarks, and if it requires to amend the report in any way, that will be done. Maurice, quickly, and another point, yeah. I think.
Just a quick point. Now, just to say, I think we've all noticed that more and more the committee's time is held is being broadcast. I mean, we see now nearly every week there's some referral to the committee. So I think it gives you the good view that how valuable this committee is.
Thank you, Maurice. And I agree, it is a very valuable committee in my view. So. Given that all members have, or those members wishing to comment have done so, can I now invite members to agree the committee's annual report and to delegate the final sign-off of the report to the convener? And if any member disagrees, can they type N in the chat bar now? I see that no member disagrees, and therefore we will progress along those lines. Finally, can I turn to agenda item 5, which is the decision on taking business in private. Members will be aware that we intend to take the legacy report of this committee at our meeting next week. Under this agenda item today, we are inviting members to agree to consider the committee's legacy report in private at a future meeting. Our members therefore agreed to take that legacy report at any future meeting in private, and if any member disagrees with that, could you please type N in the chat bar now? I note that no member disagrees, and therefore we are agreed to consider the legacy report in private at any future meeting. That concludes our business for this meeting. The next committee meeting will take place on Thursday, the 18th of March. And the clerks will update members on the arrangements for that meeting in due course. Can I now close the meeting? Thank you.